I remember when my brother was born, people would say, "Isn't it great that Mrs. Bell has a boy now?" As a small child, I found that difficult. I knew I wanted to be an astronomer, but at that stage, there weren't any women role models that I knew of. Even when I got engaged to be married, many people would congratulate me on that and say nothing about making a major astrophysical discovery. Pulsars.
The discovery of pulsars, for which you played
a girl wrote up one of astronomy's most exciting discoveries.
Of course, back then, nobody knew what a pulsar was until I found the first two. I was born in Northern Ireland, 1943. My father was an architect for the observatory in Armagh. I was in secondary school, enjoying it very much right from the beginning until the Wednesday of the first week. They sent the boys to the science laboratory and the girls to the cookery room because they were going to be homemakers. I knew that wasn't right. I tried protesting to the domestic science teacher, but she wasn't hearing anything of it. But when I told my parents that night, they hit the roof. As Quakers, we believe there is something of God in everybody, literally everybody. So everybody needed a scientific education. The next time the science class met, there were three girls and all the boys. I was reading one of my father's library books, which was an astronomy book, Frontiers of Astronomy by Fredoyle, the famous astronomer. I knew before I left school, I wanted to be a radio astronomer. Went to University of Glasgow in Scotland. I ended up being the only female in a class of 50. And it was the tradition that when a woman entered the lecture theatre, all the guys whistled, catcalled, banged their desks. I had to face this on my own. It's nasty, yes. If I hadn't been clear what I wanted to do, I would probably have gone some other way. I rather belatedly put in an application to Cambridge. I didn't think I was clever enough for this top university, but rather to my surprise, I got in. Oh, they've made a mistake admitting me. They're going to discover their mistake and throw me out. That's imposter syndrome. Got round it by deciding I would work my very hardest, so that when they threw me out, I wouldn't have a guilty conscience. Tony Hewish had this particular project to pick out compact objects called quasars, the very hot topic. So the first job was to build the radio telescope that I was to use. No, you're thinking of an optical telescope that uses light. This is a radio telescope that uses radio wavelengths to pick out very, very distant objects. Some of the radio telescopes are dishes. Ours was like an agricultural frame. We had to carry a bundle of about 20 cables that were 50 meters long. Then you'd yell, "Lift!" They all lift. And, right! This sort of caterpillar of people carrying cables. Took about half a dozen of us 2 years to build.
The array rotated with the Earth, scanning continuously, night and day, across the sky. And it was to be operated full-time by one person, a girl, the graduate student who'd helped to build it, Jocelyn Bell.
My presence as a female student was an anomaly. The only other females were the secretaries. At this stage, there was nobody else on this project. It was Tony Hewish and I. He's the person who's had the idea, and he's the person who's got the money to build the radio telescope. But it's my PhD. I'm running the telescope and I'm analysing the data. You end up with a long chart with a sort of squiggly line on it. Oh, there's a big source. That's routine chart analysis. And 5 minutes was 1 inch, so 1 foot for an hour. 24 foot a day. And I had four chart recorders going, almost 100 foot a day. There was rather more of that chart paper than I had imagined, I must say, yes. One day I was looking for quasars and there was a signal there that I couldn't explain. It wasn't a quasar and it didn't look like any kind of interference that I've seen before. I shouldn't be seeing something like that. I wanted to understand what it was. And I ended up taking this problem to Tony and he said that it was interference. He had one idea that Jocelyn had wired up the radio telescope wrongly. And it was something to do with that. I kept observing and this thing took up about a quarter inch on the charts. You actually need an enlargement to run the chart faster under the pen so everything gets spread out. So I would go out to the observatory, turn the chart onto high speed while it should have been there. At the appropriate time, switch the high speed recording and in comes pulse. Pulse, pulse. What is this? I telephoned Tony. I told him it was a string of pulses, 1 1/3 seconds apart. His immediate reaction was, oh, well, that settles it. It's interference. I knew it wasn't interference. Next day, Tony came out and he saw the pulses with his own eyes and it wasn't interference. That started a whole new research project, basically. What is it? How are we getting this curious signal? Tony and I, together, we had some ideas. I was excited to be heavily involved in discovering whatever this was. I went to ask Tony something, and the door was shut, which was most unusual. And I stumbled on a discussion between Tony and Martin Ryle, the head of the group, which in retrospect, was a discussion I think I should have been part of right from the beginning. How do we publish this result? It's incredibly hard to get people to believe you've discovered something amazing if you've only got one. I knew that finding more would be the clincher. I'm back in the lab doing some routine chart analysis and suddenly see something that looks awfully like that first pulsar had looked. I was convinced we now had two. Tony gave a colloquium in Cambridge, and every astronomer in Cambridge came. Fredoyle, the eminent astronomer that influenced me when I was a schoolgirl, was in the audience. Very exciting. Tony was doing the lecture, announcing the discovery of this new radio source. Tony could have cited me more and didn't, but I was Miss Bell, the student. Fredoyle was the first to speak.
This cosmic anarchist is the most controversial of theorists.
This is the first I've heard of these things. I think it's a supernova remnant. Fredoyle hadn't heard of these things 45 minutes previously. But within that time, he has assimilated the information and actually come up with the right explanation, the one that turns out to be correct. Gradually, it became clearer and clearer that this was hugely important. We wrote up a paper announcing the first one. And when it was published, it produced an enormous amount of interest.
They're entirely new.
The press. We'd asked Tony about the astrophysical significance of this discovery. Greater than a planet could really provide. And then they turned to me for what they called the human interest. How many boyfriends did I have at once?
Oh, yes. If
would I describe myself as brunette or blonde?
Nothing in nature could do this.
What were my bust, waist and hip measurements? How tall was I? The photographers were the worst. They wanted me to undo some buttons on my blouse.
A girl, the Jocelyn Bell.
The popular press were certainly putting me in the little girl, sexually attractive role. I barely rated as a scientist. Tony just let it happen. It was dreadful. I was leaving because I was going off to get married and husband was working elsewhere. So I had to move jobs and I left Cambridge. 1974. I was working in X-ray astronomy and the satellite we were to use was launching that morning. One of my colleagues came rushing into my office. Have you heard the news? Have you heard the news? I thought, the satellite's gone. But it wasn't. It was the announcement of the Nobel Prize.
Professor Anthony Hewish, the discovery of pulsars, for which you played a decisive role, is a most outstanding example of how, in recent years, our knowledge of the universe has been dramatically extended.
They'd given the prize jointly to Martin Ryle, who was the head of the Cambridge Radio Astronomy Group, and to Tony for pulsars. Fredoyle was quite curious for me.
And here we can see Dr. Tony Hewish, who will tell us more about it.
When you plan a ship of discovery and somebody up the masthead says, land ho, that's great. But I mean, who actually inspired it and conceived it and decided what to do, when, and so on? I mean, there is a difference between skipper and crew.
I think the fact that I was a graduate student and a woman together demoted my standing in terms of receiving a Nobel Prize. It didn't bother me. I was actually pleased. I was really pleased that pulsars were considered important enough to rate a Nobel Prize. The very name pulsar is an abbreviation of pulsating radio star. It's the remains of a big star that exploded near the end of its life. And this tiny star is spinning. And as it spins, it sweeps a radio wave around the sky. And if it shines in your face, you see pulse, 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 pulse. But if it doesn't shine in your face, you don't see anything. Now, whether if I'd stayed single, I think things might have been very different. I think I would have been offered a postdoctoral place in Cambridge. I would probably continue to working in radio astronomy the whole of my career. and be a much more narrow-minded astronomer as a result. But I've actually had huge fun in my career, even if it has not been a string of prestigious jobs. It's been a string of very, very interesting jobs, usually working in great places with great colleagues. July 2018, I had a phone call from Ed Witten, who's a very eminent Princeton physicist, saying that I'd won this breakthrough prize. For the discovery of pulsars. The reason I discovered pulsars was because I was a bit of an outsider who, you know, felt maybe not entitled to be there and so on. And I thought if I could give more minority people an opportunity to do PhDs, some exciting things might emerge. Phone up the chief executive of the Institute of Physics and say, hello, Paul. Could the Institute of Physics use a $3 million award to provide research studentships for people from minorities? And he didn't hesitate, he said yes. Fredoyle influenced me and turned me on to astronomy. It's important to be a good role model. I do think it's important that there are role models for young women, so okay, I'll be it.